I can't think of a more important topic than to continue to keep us as a church focused on the godly nature we should have as a church of the living God. We represent Jesus Christ on this earth. And you say, well, I am that representative. Yes, you're an ambassador. But when we come together as the church, we are to outshine the sun.
Amen.
We should be alive. There should be something happening in the context of the church because Christ is among us. He certainly is alive. Can anybody say Christ is alive? See, when we embrace the idea that Christ is alive and we come together in a divine assembly that he says, I am in the midst, then something alive should be happening. Amen? We don't come together to be dead. We come together for life and to have it more abundantly, to be stretched, to be challenged, to be encouraged, to be upheld, to be supported in every kind of way. We need church.
Yes.
We need church.
Yes. Hallelujah.
And the church needs me.
Amen.
Do you see the bi-directional connection? We are both individually and we're corporately wound, woven together by Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, and by the Holy Spirit who knits us together in such a way that no man can take apart. The church, the nature of the church is crucial to understand how that interaction should happen. One of the most confusing ideas when we talk, in fact, let me give you four, just real quick, that just came to my mind, four things that's very, very important in the context of the church as we meet. We need seekers, and I don't mean the way people define seeker now as terms of levels of people's spirituality or something. I'm not saying that. I'm talking about every person in the church needs to be a seeker of the Lord Jesus Christ, of his truth, of his what he wants for us, of what he has for us, the steps in obedience that we can make and be a part of his kingdom. We should be seekers of Christ. Secondly, we should desire the gifts of the Spirit. The church needs to have seekers. The church needs to have the gifts of the Spirit that are alive and well in the body of Christ. The body of Christ should have the fruit of the Spirit growing out of it from the inside out, reaching out into our communities, into our workplaces, into the things and the areas that we live in, into our families, into our friends, all of those kind of places. The fruit of the Spirit should be very much a part of our lives and growing out of the center point, which is the church. And fourthly, the idea of obedience. See, if we have seekers, we have the gifts of the Spirit, we have the fruit of the Spirit, and we have obedient servants of the Most High God, it's going to cover the bases. Somebody say amen. It's going to be amazing to be there. Now, if we have those four things, it's not about size. Do you know that the smallest of people, numbers-wise, can have the huge impact? I can prove that in the Word of God. 12 people completely changed the world for Jesus Christ. God doesn't need an army. He doesn't need this huge, huge group of people. He just needs some people dedicated, some people seeking him, some people being obedient to him, people that are engaged in the gifts of the Spirit, the fruit of the Spirit, obeying him. Can you say amen to that?
Amen.
Okay. Well, today I want to talk, and not only this Sunday, you see that it says part one, but for several Sundays, I'm going to be talking about the gifts of the Spirit, which are one of the key components of the church. It's very, very important that we understand what this is all about and the overview to that. So I'm going to begin with what I would call the purpose. That's a good starting point of an overview of the gifts of the Spirit. Let me start with a purpose. And then when we can keep the purpose in mind, then when we get down to the details, it's a lot more, it's so much better to understand in context of the purpose. You with me? Anybody with me? It's always good to have the big picture, and then in all the little details tie in better, don't they? Well, that's what I'm trying to do today. Now, I'm going to, with the title, I'm trying to give you an indication of where we're going with this. Gifts independently given, what does that mean? To moi. Everybody just go, moi. That sounded really bad. Me, that would be better, I guess. But anyway, gifts independently given, meaning that God himself has gifted you in some way if you are a believer in Jesus Christ. Bam. There you go. That's the truth. All right? Now, independently given for corporate good. This is where things we forget about that. The reason for the gifts are for the corporate good. And I want us to see where I'm talking about. And I'm going to give you context. So it's a lot of verses, 14 of them. Here we go. You ready for context? Here we go. You ready?
Ready.
Say, I want it, Pastor. Come on, talk to me a little bit. Now, concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I do not want you to be ignorant. You know that you were Gentiles carried away to these dumb idols, however you were led, meaning that you were led to those idols. Therefore, I make known to you that no one speaking by the Spirit of God calls Jesus accursed. And no one can say that Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. There are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are differences of ministries, but the same Lord. And there are diversity of activities, but it's the same God who works all in all. Christ is all in all. Christ is all in all. And he works all in all. But the manifestation, here's the key verse. I want you to say key verse with me. Key verse. All the other stuff. Now, this is the key verse I want to talk to you about right here. What's the key verse? Verse 7. Underline it. Key verse. Overview. Here's the reason. But the manifestation of the Spirit, in context, talking about the gifts, is given to each one for the profit of all. Say it. All. Come on. All. Whew. For to one is given the word of wisdom through the Spirit, to another the word of knowledge through the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by the same Spirit, to another the workings of miracles, to another prophecy, to another discerning of spirits, to another different kind of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. But one and the same Spirit works all these things, distributing to each one individually as he wills. For as the body is one and has many members, but all the members of that one body, being many, are one body, so also is Christ. For by one Spirit we are all baptized into one body, whether Jews or Greeks, whether saved or free, and have been made to drink into one Spirit. For in fact, the body is not one member, you, not one. It's not one. How many? But many.
Amen.
But we are all one. Whoo! Man, that was a mouthful, wasn't it? All right, now listen, Paul doesn't want the church, everybody say, that's me.
That's me.
That's me. See, I am, all of us together are the church, and Christ is the head. Let's get it right, okay? Listen to me carefully. Christ is the head. We, you and me, are the body. Do you get this? The body has a head. It's Christ. Why wouldn't we want to be identified with the body of Christ, right? He doesn't want the church to be ignorant when it comes to spiritual gifts. There's clear direction that's going on here. There is something very important for you to know. And here is, and I believe what I'm going to dwell on today is the heart of the passage, what it means to be a Christian individually, and what does it mean to be the church corporately in the context of gifts. And I think it's very important for us to get this. Each believer is given a spiritual gift or gifts for the good of the church. That's the truth. That's what it's for. Now, the supporting passage is, but the manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. Now, in some renderings of the Scripture, it says, for the common good. Does anybody have that in their Bible? For the common good. I love that. I like it better than the profit of all. It's the idea of the common good. Because the context here is the church. He's addressing the church, and he's talking to the church. Come on, church. You're the church. It's for your good. You know how many people run away when you use the word spiritual gift? No. If you use the two words spiritual gifts, they run off. I don't want to talk about that. It makes me nervous. I'm afraid of it. What are you afraid of? It's for the common good, church. And you say, yeah, but this happened, that happened. Listen, the bastardization of gifts by Satan, or the false rendering of spiritual gifts by Satan, does not negate the truth. And the truth is every believer has been given a spiritual gift for the good of the church. End of story.
Amen.
That's the truth.
That's right. Hallelujah.
And we stand on the truth, and the truth shall set you free.
Amen.
Amen? Now, here's the truth. We go on and it talks about the common good of the church. If you want to do good to others, you manifest God to them.
Yes.
Quit thinking in terms, I'm going to, you know, feed them. I'm going to give them some clothes. I'm going to, you know, give them a Hershey bar. I'm going to, you know, quit thinking that way. Think in this way. I'm going to manifest God to them. Woo, come on, somebody say hallelujah. I mean, I have that ability. I have that. How do I know that? God lives in me. When I show up, God shows up. Come on. And when God shows up, I can manifest God to someone else. Listen, I've just done somebody good. It can be a word. It can be an action. It can be serving food. It doesn't matter what it is. Come on, it's doing something good to them means that I'm manifesting God to them. If you want to manifest God and make him known, you do good to others.
Amen.
See, the church should be all about doing good to one another.
Amen.
Especially the household of faith.
Amen.
Doing good to one another. We don't just come and leave. And we don't just come and never show up again. We don't just come and never say hi to people and love on people and care about. Listen, you're gifted. What's wrong with you? You got to use that gift for the common good. For the common good. It's for all. And here's the problem. Some in the church in general try to experience God's manifestations alone. And they don't do in the church. Here's the idea. I'm going to go have this experience at home or at my work somewhere, and I'm going to have the Holy Spirit's gift manifested in all sorts of ways. But in the church, they're not active and engaged and part of what God wants us to do. See, you got to understand the context of what Paul is talking about here is that we are interdependent of one another. Interdependent. And you have one gift, I have a gift, you have a gift, you have a gift. And when we are dependent on one another, and we are, then we're busy about sharing those gifts together for the common good that's going to encourage and build up and strengthen, and life is going to flow here. Life will flow. Now, they may have some ecstatic experience with God, and I don't discount that at all. I'm telling you, any encounter with God is ecstatic to me.
Amen.
You know what I'm talking about? I mean, it puts Holy Ghost goosebumps all over you, you know? And that's good. You can have that at home. You can have it driving down the road. You can have it out digging a ditch or digging a hole, a fence post or whatever. Listen, all those things are good. I'm not saying they're not good, but keep in mind that I am gifted for the common good of the church of the living God. It's not for my goosebumps out on a fence post somewhere. You know what I mean? That's not what the purpose, that's part of it, and you have that. But you are gifted for the common good called the church of the living God. See, God is the kind of God who manifests himself for the common good. I love that. Not for individualistic, some kind of a religious experience. That's not his end goal here. Although they will happen. And I get that. I have those. Okay? I get that. And I want to be very, very clear. At Pure Heart Fellowship, the pursuit. Now listen carefully. I'm already past the amount of time most people will listen. I want you to listen right here. Okay? Let's be very, very clear at PHF. The pursuit of the manifestation of the Spirit. The pursuit of the gifts of the living God. Let me say it that way. Is that clear?
Yeah.
That's the manifestation of the Spirit. The pursuit, and we should, I don't want you to be ignorant in this. We should desire spiritual gifts. We should pursue the spiritual gifts. They should be something we long for and ask God to give to us. That's perfectly fine. So the pursuit of those gifts and the pursuit of what is good for PHF are not two separate pursuits. They're the same pursuit. They're good pursuits. They're one and the same. What we need for our lives and gifts is what our church needs in its life. Are you with me? We need it. And God is manifesting through you via the gifts to do good via the church. Now, it's not that you can't do good outside of the church. You can, and that's good. But don't forget, the main theme here is the body of Christ. Do you get that? It is his body with him being the head. And I believe it's the church where these two things come together. It's the only place it can come together is in the concept of the divine assembly. Any other place is just you are exercising your gift. And if you have, I guess, more than two or three, I guess it can be that. But a lot of times we exercise our gifts to those that are unsaved or those that are doubtful, those that don't have any faith. And we're the encourager because we're gifted for that. Or we are the one that with faith because we're gifted. But I know you can't believe for healing, but I will. What are you saying? I have the gift of faith. You may have the gift of faith to believe for somebody else, even though they don't believe. You ask and call down healing from heaven from God. Amen? There can be 800 in disbelief, like the prophets that were worshiping Baal, and Elijah was the one that was worshiping God, and he called down fire from heaven, and they cut themselves and danced and did all that stuff, and you know, for hours and hours and hours and hours, and nothing happened. You know, Elijah said, drench it with water and dig a trench and fill it all up, and then one simple prayer, bam, fire came down from heaven. We can do that in the face of doubters. But the goal is God's people. He did all that so that the people would bow down. And here's what they said. The Lord, he is God. The Lord, he is God. So what did he do all that stuff on Mount Carmel for? He did it so that the people would come back to him and be his people. So anyway, that's the introduction. Now let's get started. Whoops. This was going to take a little longer than I thought. All right, hang in there now. We'll be done before the ball game. The context of the spirit of manifestation. Now get this. The context that Paul is talking about related to the spirit manifestations. What is the spirit manifestations in context? The gifts of the Spirit. Okay? Now, he says, but the manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. You got to start with the two words, each one. I'm looking at the big picture. Each one. Okay. Am I part of that each one? In other words, the who? Is that me? Are we talking about me here? You know? And he says, you know that you were Gentiles carried away to these dumb idols, however you were led. Therefore, I make known to you that no one speaking by the Spirit of God calls Jesus accursed. Now, catch this. And no one can say that. Give me the next three words. What? What? It doesn't say just Jesus can say Jesus by the Holy Spirit. It says Jesus is Lord. Whew! Underscore that. This is a huge distinction. See, Gentiles were led away from Christ by dumb idols that say nothing, that do nothing, that no miracles come from. You know, you go to India, New Delhi, you can go out, and I did, and there were I've been there about three or four times, and there, as I go on to other areas in India, but in that context, you can go down the street, one of these busy streets, there are God shops, and you can walk into the God shop, and you can buy any idol that you want, any God idol you want. It could be an elephant or a monkey or a thing, you know, with the arms coming up and over and around. You go, how'd they get in that contortion? You know, I mean, some kind of a deranged mind put that stuff together, and they can buy those gods, and people will take them and put them on their shelves, and they will pray to the God that says nothing, that can do nothing, that can be nothing. But a statue on a wall. The Gentiles were led away. But now, listen, here's the indication Paul has given us. But now. I just think this is incredible. But now Christ has saved me. And because of the work of the Holy Spirit, He has changed everything. I once rejected God, and now I can call Jesus Lord. Come on. Can you call him Lord? Can you say, Jesus is Lord? Say it.
Jesus is Lord.
See, you can only say that by the power of the Spirit that's within you, if you mean it. So, each one are people who live under the lordship of Christ, who has the desire to do what he says to do. Now, this is the manifestation of the Spirit. It's the only way we can live like this. Now, get this. Many will say to me in this day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name, cast out demons in your name, and done many wonders in your name? Then I will declare to them, man, this scares me half to death, I never knew you, depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. So it's not just that I can say Jesus, right? It's not just that I can say Jesus or I can know about Jesus. I have to call him Lord. And because they practice lawlessness, I must be about practicing who he is that demonstrates the realness of what I'm believing in my heart. Now, that doesn't negate the idea that by faith, by grace and faith, you're saved, right? I mean, it doesn't negate that at all. It just says, I'm really saved. That's what it does. When I practice righteousness, when I'm walking in that, it's showing and demonstrating. The gifts of the Spirit is showing and demonstrating that we're walking in that righteousness. Hallelujah. We mean it. We live it. We say it. Jesus is Lord. He runs my life. I consult with him. I follow his commands. And when I fall short, I repent. I seek his forgiveness and I press on. And this all comes by the Spirit of the living God. His business is to make lordship real in my life. But we all, with unveiled face, beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are being what? What? Come on, what? Into the same image from glory to glory, just as by the Spirit of the Lord. Whew. This is who Paul's talking about, the each one. I've set my face like a flint. Now, this is old days. We used to have flints around my house, and my dad would take the flint out, and it's kind of like a stone, and he would take the knives, only a few good knives, a butcher knife, and I mean, sounds horrible now, doesn't it? I don't think it's even politically correct to say butcher knife. But anyway, he would take that knife and he would stroke it on that flint. And you know what? The knife was a little bit less hard than the flint, and the flint would begin to shave off of that knife. And then he would look at it, and he would go like this, and he would stroke it the other way. And then he would get into a move of stroking this way, and he would put such a fine edge on that thing, you could shave your arm. Razor sharp. Christ wants us to be razor sharp for Him. Amen. The Holy Spirit wants to develop us into the carving knife of this world. Razor sharp, where we make a huge difference. The second thing is the Spirit. And it says, but the manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. And also, if we looked above this verse, in verse 11 it says, but one and the same Spirit works all these things, distributing to each one individually as He wills. So, there's no question, you already know this. I'm just going to tell you what you already know. The Holy Spirit is the giver of all gifts. Can you say amen? We differ in our gifts, and there's no question about that. And we differ in our ministries, there's no question about that. And we differ even in the effectiveness of the ministry. Now, hang with me on this point. We will differ in all of these things, gifts, ministries, and the effectiveness of the ministry. But all of these are from one Spirit. Do you think it's my job to be effective in the ministry of preaching the gospel? Is it my job to be effective in a sense of somehow I've got to have a certain number of people coming to Christ or a certain number of people in the chairs or a certain number of people when I, you know, is it my job to do all that? My job is to know God, to take the gift that He's given me, make sure it's as sharp as it can be, whittled on that stone until I am razor sharp with what I'm going to be preaching about and talking about, and I step up, and whoever is there, he who has ears, let him hear. It is God's job to do the effectiveness of the ministry. Amen. Not mine. And I need to be careful. You can grow weary. You can grow disgruntled. You can grow unhappy because things are not what you want them to be. Woo. Now, wait a minute. What you want them to be.
That's right.
We have to be careful. Because God is doing exactly what He wants to do. Secondly, the Holy Spirit decides what gifts I will have. Don't let somebody else tell you, you're supposed to have this gift. In fact, you better hurry up and get it. And if you don't have it, you're dying and going to hell. I mean, whoo! Where is that coming from? Somebody tell me what passage supports that idea. That's being ignorant about the gifts. The Holy Spirit clearly decides what to give, to whom He will give, and guarantees every believer, true believer, will have a gift. And many of us have multiple gifts. And it's amazing to me how he blesses us with that. And in this room, I can go around and I could point fingers, I won't. People that have gift of faith, gift of works, gift of administration, gift of, you name it, of the prophetic, of the idea of the preacher, pastor, teacher. I mean, I could point. And yet, there's plenty of people in this room, they go, I have no idea what I got. Okay. Listen, it's not your decision to make. I love that. Live your life for Christ. Make Him Lord. He'll worry about the rest. Come on, man. Quit worrying about it. Just live for the Lord Jesus Christ. He will put it on you. Others will begin to see it in you. You will exercise it and say, I'm happy. I'm at peace with myself because I'm doing what God is saying for me to do. There is nothing better ever in your life than to feel as though you're in the center of the will of God. Exercising the gift God has given you. Doing what God has called you to do. There's no better place to be. He fills us, he embraces us, he rules us, in us and over us. Amen. Isn't that awesome? Amen. I love that. And he is sovereign with what he does. And you know, don't take, because we're talking about God the Holy Spirit, don't take the sovereignty of God away from him. Amen. He's just as much God as God the Father, God the Son. Amen. His sovereign will is what decides it. Okay, let's move on. We got to move on. All right, the word manifestation. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. And I'm going to be brief today because I'm going to expound more on that next Sunday and the next Sunday, okay? But in terms of what are the gifts and then how are we to use them and things like that. So I'll address those types of things later. But let me just start by saying that the manifestation is at the very root of this idea of showing. If you really dug deep into the word meaning for manifestation, here's what you would come back with. It is a showing. Let that sink in. It is a showing. Now, the reason the Spirit gives us gifts, ministries, and effectiveness is so he will be manifested in the church. He will have a showing in the church. When you manifest something, you bring it to light. You expose it. You bring it to light for all to see. And the Spirit manifestations are always to exalt and to glorify the Lord Jesus Christ, which will move me to the lordship of Christ forever and ever and ever, evermore. There is nothing about self related to the showing of the gift. In other words, we exercise it, which reveals, which manifests. We exercise the gift, which manifests a showing that the gift exists, which is the root, is the Holy Spirit of God. And we look to the heavens and go, praise be to God for that gift. We need to be careful that we don't slap them on the back too much and say, you're awesome. You're not. You're a stinking no good sinner. You're not awesome. God in you is awesome. We need to be careful and give credit where credit's due. It's never me. It's always him.
That's right. Hallelujah.
So at the root is the idea of a manifestation, a showing. And then the work of the church is completely supernatural. You got to get a hold of this. Understand this at the deepest level. You think we're just going to go watch a ball game and sit out there and eat the wings or whatever we're eating? I don't know what it is, but you think that's all it is? Just get fat party? And watch the boys play. This is a supernatural event that we want to minister to people's souls.
Amen.
Woo! We need every gift we've got out there.
That's right. Thank the Lord.
Are you with me? We need every gift that this neighborhood could see so that the manifestation, the showing of the Spirit of the living God is upon us, that they say something is different about this very place. Do you realize that this supernatural idea is the connection between you and God? That is the supernatural event that's taking place. The sinful man, the holy God, and he, through Jesus Christ and his blood, now has a connection with you, has gifted you with the Spirit of the living God that says he'll manifest that gift through you so that others can see God. Whoo, man. Somebody say hallelujah. Whoo, that's amazing stuff. See, God, the Holy Spirit, becomes visible. The Spirit who no one can see. Only the effects Can you see? In other words, like the wind blowing. How do you know the wind's blowing? Do you look at the wind? I don't think so. What do you look at, Gomer? The trees. The shingles blowing on the roof. You hear the howling around the house. You know the wind's blowing. Why? Because of the effects of the wind. You know a person is lit up by Jesus Christ, that Christ is Lord of his life, by the effects of the gifts of the Holy Spirit that is within them, that begins to show God to everyone they come in contact with. See, you're to show the Spirit for the church to see. Because we're in the supernatural business. Do you get this? We're in the supernatural business. There's not one thing we do that's not supernatural. Huh?
Hallelujah.
Does that excite y'all? Do you need to get up and stretch or anything? See, I think one of the greatest travesties of a church is when it digresses to be run by human effort alone. This tries to glorify man and not the Spirit of the living God. I've been in churches. I've seen it. Where forgive me. I was raised here, so I have the freedom to talk about it. I was raised in this. The deacon body is in control. What do you mean? The Lord is saying to me that we should do this. Let's at least have an audience. Oh, they've heard it before. They don't want to hear it again. What? But God is all over me, and I know this is what this will be. You either shut up or we're going to take you out. Okay. God forbid you ever hear that kind of thought process here. Now, it is right to go to the elders and bring your thoughts to the elders, and we talk about it and we engage it and we pray about it. And if it's good with the Spirit, it's good with us. End of story. That's it. That's the way it runs around here. Other places, not so. But it's awesome to see you at PHF. This is what I love. It's awesome to see you at PHF that rely on the Spirit again and again and again. That people are stepping forward to do things they had never done before in their entire life. And they're doing it because they love God. Amen. And He's allowing that seeing, that showing to take place. I'm encouraged to see the Spirit manifesting Himself among you. Amen. And I want to encourage you, whatever you do, do in the power of the Spirit with the remembrance. Listen, that's supernatural. David, now listen careful. David, you said yes to putting sprinkler heads on today. It's not like you're going to work putting sprinkler heads on or anything else you do it there. David, listen, when you show up on this place, you're doing a supernatural work. Do you know, I don't know how many cars go up and down the street and they see somebody out there putting sprinklers in. It's a supernatural. God can put on their heart. Look at that. Somebody's serving God by doing that. That's awesome. Let's go by and visit that church. It's a supernatural work. Preparing the food. No one sees, but it gets done. It's a supernatural work. Guess who does see it? Bam! Guess who does see it? Christ sees it all. Is there anything He misses?
No.
Nothing He misses, right? We got to move on, or we're going to run into the Cowboy game. Prophet for all. Okay? Prophet for all. And I like the phrase better in the scripture rendering that says common good. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all, or the common good. Now, this is a result of gifts given to each one of us, you and I. And good comes to every one of us, the common good, the people coming together. I'm encouraged, I'm strengthened, I've been blessed. I mean, somebody handed me what I needed. Happy birthday was saying to me today, I feel good, you know? And my wife said, it looked good.
Hallelujah.
after she redressed me. I'm just saying, that's what happened, okay? It's good for people to see God. Amen? Who among us would argue with that? And then we are the instrument God wants to use to say, let people see God through you. Yes. We argue with that all the time. Here's how we argue with it. We say, I don't want to go to church today. Man, I've worked all day. I'm so tired. I worked all day. It's not about, you come to church, you'll be energized. Amen. The word of, I don't want to come to church, it ain't coming from God. That's coming from the devil. It's coming from the pit of hell. Let me tell you something. Not coming to church is one of the greatest problems with the church today. Too many people see it as I'm going to a soccer game. It's just another activity. It is totally not true. This is supernatural gathering. I love that. I mean, hey, let's go to the supernatural gathering. Yeah, that's what you're doing. So the Spirit is manifested in you, your gift, for the profit of the body. The Spirit does not give gifts and ministries so that you and I can boast in them in any way, any shape, any form. He gives gifts and ministries for the manifestation of Himself to help us do good to each other in the church. That's the context of this passage, in the church. So, it leads me to this truth. Gifts are for the glory of God and the good of the church. Why in the world would we be afraid of them? Worried about them? Let the elders worry about it. That's what the Bible teaches the elders to be on guard. Look out for false witnesses. Look out for wolves in sheep's clothing. It's our job to look out for all that. Don't you worry. Listen, you seek God with all your heart. You let Him be Lord of your life. Let the Holy Spirit gift you as He will. And you use, exercise that gift according to the... Whoa, this